Thank you everyone for coming to the talk today evening. And thank you to BCS for recognizing the work we have been doing in this area of combining shape with function. It's my great pleasure to be in this very special venue today and have the opportunity to give this talk. I'm hesitating a bit because I'm expecting any moment Mark to come in and he will introduce me. I'll take this opportunity to pass this toy around. Please be careful not to drop it. For those who have seen it before, you would know what it is, so but don't say it to your neighbors. Otherwise, look at it and try to guess what it can be useful for. And you will also find an envelope on your chair, and it might have some strange pieces in it, and it will hopefully come make some sense as we go along with the talk. Right? Okay. So being in this very special venue, so I thought it was quite natural that I say a little bit about this. And I find that when I read the book, that this was one of the first examples I could think of big data. And how is that? Because this person collected data for a large number of years, and then he went ahead and formed a theory explaining what the implication of this, right? What is less known, but maybe to this audience is quite well known, is this other book, which was a follow-up. I won't say a follow-up, but he took a different view, more from coming from mathematics, and only in 2010, I think, we celebrated his 150th anniversary. So it is very highly recommended if you haven't read this book. I read it, luckily, during my PhD years, and that shaped my large part of my thesis. And this chapter 17 of this book talks about how you can link different shapes by transformations. And by shapes here are objects, or not objects, but by fishes and animals and like this, right? What is maybe less commonly cited is chapter 16, which talks about form and stains, strain and stress relations. And if you look at it, he explains why truss structures are really good, while our FEMU structure has this very grain patterns. And by the way, that's also how the structure for the Eiffel Tower, the original Eiffel Tower, was designed based on the stress distribution of the FEMU of our bone. So let's keep this in mind. So the idea is we collect data, and from that we try to explain what's going on about shapes and create better shapes. In architecture, this very short paper by Sullivan, you can find a PDF on the wiki. It's maybe a 10-page paper, something like that. But there is a word from here, or a phrase from here, which you probably all have heard about. And there's a lot of debate if this is true or not, right? If form follows function or the other way. But it is that when we are in man-made environments, the function of objects affects how we design and build shapes. And there is a relation when we go and capture this, having this prior helps a lot, right? So if you think of what we do in computer graphics, if you're outside the domain, you say, oh, these guys make pretty pictures, which is largely a part of computer graphics. And that's, by the way, very, very difficult to make it realistic pictures. But more recently, what has happened is we are getting more easy devices for capturing shapes, right? So there's various ways of capturing. And now we don't just stop at producing an image. We also produce printed objects or fabricated objects, like the blue stuff that you see when it reaches you. This was 3D printed from here. Okay, so that sounds all very exciting. But let's say, what are the ways of creating 3D models, right? So if you have been lucky or unlucky in trying to model yourself, this is not very, very simple. Things have improved with SketchUp. This should be SketchUp, I think. So with SketchUp, it's a bit more intuitive, but still it takes a lot of experience, expertise to create it. On the other hand, if you talk about 3D scanning, there's a lot that has happened recently. And I think multiple of the Kinect team is here, which is a very special privilege to have them in the audience. So what has happened now is now you can go ahead and capture very, very large scenes, right? So this is a scene of a building, and it goes down at the resolution of the rooms inside, right? But the question is, with these millions of points, what do we do with it, right? So this is a representation that requires certain expertise to use. So if you keep that in mind, let's think about who are the users who's going to use it, right? And I would argue that you would be in one of the following three categories. You can be an occasional user who'd like to try out a new 3D printer, maybe download a model or print something, or maybe make small changes. Or maybe you are more like I do, I try to build a lot of things myself. So you will experiment with whatever tools or collections you have to be able to create a shape that suits your function, right? So you have, beyond just keeping it on your bookshelf, you have some target usage for it, right? And then there are professionals who really design shapes and make shapes and create it. And they can be engineers, they can be architects, they can be designers, they can be product designers, et cetera. Right? And they have a different expectation. So for a user, it's just simple that I just want to decide which one I want to pick. For a hobbyist, they would just change the parameters so that it fits the dimensions of the design problem you have in mind. Or a professional, really keen of finding new shapes. And this is a very interesting aspect that we'll come to. But there's also dialogues between these communities. For example, you want to build a house and you involve an architect. You have to explain your design decisions or design expectations to this architect. And they have to design something, and then they have to convey back how realistic it is back to the user or back to the person who's doing it. Okay? Now, to enable these type of interactions, we need something beyond this very raw data. We need an abstraction that allows a transaction or a dialogue between these different set of people and also makes easier to interact, optimize, and manipulate these shapes. So that's a summary of my research interest. So the a part of my group that we have been working a lot on acquiring shapes, acquiring 3D shapes. And this can be based on scanning, where it can be modeling tools, can be imaging. And this is the part I thought I will not talk about today, because I have only a part of my time here. And I see Mark Alexa here. I should thank Mark a lot for coming all the way from Berlin. And the fog was just beyond what you could do. Please come in. The other part, which is what I find most excited about and what I spend most of my time on, is shape analysis of analyzing shapes and coming up with revealing their structures and shape priors. And a part of me would like to claim that this is what Darwin was doing, this is what Descartes was doing, et cetera, taking data and creating shapes from that. And then in the last part of the talk, I will talk about how this can be used to create better design in terms of design new shapes in consideration with the different functions it can have. Okay? And of course, there's a cyclic dependency that you would like to go between these. Okay? So for now, we will talk about this one. Okay. So let's talk about this building. Being in London, I think most of you are familiar of this building. And you can also see Darwin sitting there, which is also quite nice. But this is, when I went there after moving to London, I noticed like this is very redundant and there's lots of symmetry here. I do ignore there's some spiral symmetry here, which is a bit more subtle, but for this image, this is sufficient. So we don't need to understand or work on the whole representation, but we can keep half of it, keeping in mind that this is symmetric. Right? So this is the main idea of factoring out symmetry and regularity. So a part of what I'm going to start with is the symmetry and regularity. How do you get from 3D shapes? And how do you abstract it out? And in one of the puzzle pieces you have, this is one of the pieces, and that's the symmetry you would like to get. Okay? So when I talk about symmetry, you have to talk about type of symmetry, which transformation groups you are considering, which orbits you are considering, et cetera. And I'm going to talk about a series of work here, but I will build it up as we go. So the most common ones are reflection, which you know that you reflect and you get a reflective symmetry. You can bring in rigid transforms, which is rotations and translations, so another 6 degrees. You can also involve uniform scaling. Right? The part that really makes things interesting and challenging is when you talk about partial symmetry or part maps to another, this suddenly makes the problem significantly more difficult. If you talk about global symmetry, this is almost trivial to find. And the other one is we have to fight noise versus approximate symmetries. So being an evening talk, I thought I will walk through this example very slowly because it's a fairly simple idea. So the problem is, if we go back in the previous slide, is we have these parts that are mapping to another part of the object, which we call a global matching, and that makes it difficult to computationally solve. Right? So we will do a trick to or a technique to bring it down to a more tractable problem. So let's study the problem a little bit. So if we take a pair of points on this butterfly example, then their witness to their being symmetric is their line of reflection. And for those who are familiar with Hopf transform, this will be reminiscent at this point. So this vertical line is a witness that these two points are symmetric. Right? Not the points, the patches around these points. And we can take this line and map it to a point in some transformation space. So what happened is we took a pair of points and mapped it to a point in this transformation space. And now if we take another pair, it will also indicate another line, and that will map to another point. But the key part is that's mapping to another part of the plane or the domain because these are different lines or different planes in this case. Okay? Now, the interesting part, if we go back to the dominant line of symmetry, they would also cast a vote or a point in the same region. And we can keep doing this. And so if we take another pair here, it will cast a vote here. Then here's another pair. They are all casting votes in the same region. Okay? So that's the main idea here. Now, if we continue voting like this, as you see, this big pair, this is a line which is not the symmetric line, and it will cast a vote somewhere else. So in the end, we will have a collection of points like this. And then if we look at the dominant set of cluster, that will be coming from these multiple lines that voted for the same thing. So this is a fairly simple idea what's going on. Now, the more interesting bit is the small part, or the part which is partly symmetric, will also cast a vote, and they will lead to a lower peak. So if you look here, this tall peak is coming from this dominant symmetry of the butterfly, and the small ones are coming from here. Now, that's the intuitive explanation of the algorithm, but there's a lot of subtlety of how many samples we need to draw, and these can all be worked out probabilistically to be sure under some noise model how much sampling we need to do. Right? So, to summarize, what we have done is we have mapped this height of clusters to the size of patch or the extent of symmetry and the spread of cluster to the level of approximate. Right? And there is inherent ambiguity between level of symmetry and the noise in the data. And you can do this with rigid transform, and you can get these abstractions out of this. So what we have done is we have taken the point cloud, which was maybe around 2 million points there, and now we get these arrows, these black arrows, are the abstractions, because these are the relation between the parts that you get. Okay? But the bigger insight here is we have mapped the symmetry detection to be a clustering problem, which is a local problem, and we have good handles of how to combine them. So that's the first observation we have. Now, beyond symmetry, we can go to regularity. So again, if you look back in the small patterns you have, there is a particular arrangement of the slits you have, which relates to the orbit of how things are rotated in there. So now we are not determining instances of just repetitions, but you are also finding the orbits in the transformation groups. Okay? So let's look at this problem again. So you take a set of points, and then you map it to a set in the transformation domain. So what happened, you take a pair of points here and you let them vote in this transformation domain. Now it's a six-dimensional space because we have rotation and translation. And this is showing a slice of the six-dimensional place. And then if we take appropriate slices, what we get are a collection of points. Right? But these are not points as in the original data. These are points in this abstracted data, right? In this transformation space. Now, our problem is we want to find patterns in this space. Right? Now, this sounds very difficult. You can find any patterns here because you can connect the dot and say that's a pattern. But we want to be a bit more systematic. Now, here what happens is this is the transformation domain, so it has a lot more structure than in the original space. For example, this circle, the point that I've circled, that is the origin, or that is the identity transform, the transformation that maps object to itself, right? So this always exists. And since we are looking for generators in the transformation group, so essentially in this space we are looking in for particular grids or two parameter families of translation or rotations in this case. So if I show you these more colored points, if we go back here, because I should have said here, not all these points fall on the grid because there is noise here. So what we also are trying to find is some sort of a confidence here. And now maybe you see a pattern emerging here between this. Remember that circle point was the origin. So this is the pattern that you are seeing underneath. So this sort of tells you the difficulty of the problem that we are solving. We are solving for a weight of the points and this distribution of the grid that here. But the reason we can solve it is because we are looking for this particular transformations which has some nice properties that allows us not to look for any grid but a particular type of grid. Okay? And if you map these results back, we get these type of grids as you see here. Okay? To summarize this part, what we took is local geometry where the points, in this case polygons, because we had to estimate some curvature behavior here. And what we have is sort of a decoupling into a repetition grid, and there are different colors for the different types of elements, and these are the patterns. So this figure should be understandable very easily. So what we took is a 3D shape and decomposed it into a very lightweight structure and these elements. So these elements are what the nodes are. If you place them and repeat them over, you get the structure on the left. So we have decomposed this millions of points or polygons into a very simple to handle and analyze data structure, so, which makes this thing easier. Of course, at that point, I was aware of this on growth and form, so, but I also found this chamber nutula, so I scanned it. So this is the scan output of 72 laser scans put together. And of course, if you have worked with a laser scanning, even if it's very high quality, you would expect these thin regions to be missed. Right? So this was a great example where we could use our technique to extract this repetition pattern. Now it's this spiral pattern that you see on the blue. And then the real test for any of these algorithms is, can you take it and extrapolate it out? So in this case, can you take it and take measurements from here? You have the transformation, you move it back, and consolidate the data, as you see here. And when I did this experiment, I was personally very, very amazed and moved, because it's amazing to see how accurately these 3D, very thin lines actually line up to get the structure. Ignore the one at the middle, which works out nicely, but this should not be taken as measurement, because we have empty region, and this is just extrapolating. So I think that's just the beauty of these type of objects, right? You can get it very crisply. And I should warn you that it's important that we have enough chambers to detect these blue patterns with reasonable accuracy, right? If you have only two or three, then you can't extrapolate from that. It took us many years, so this is a result from earlier this year, that you can go ahead and do this extraction and consolidation at the same point and extract this transformation. So this was the point cloud I showed you, and the student is in the audience for this one. And this is the abstracted result, which are the planes that were automatically detected from here. And this was done at the same time. So the arrangement of the planes and the assignments of the points to the planes was done at the same time. And if you have worked in domain, you would appreciate that how interesting this result is. So if you zoom in on that data, you would see that the stairs, they were detected quite nicely, and the same color means they're parallel planes, right? So these parallel planes were automatically detected along with their directions without any prior that these are linked. So the coupling was found out in course of the optimization, okay? So what we have done at this point, we have seen two methods of taking raw measurements and getting them down to some structure in the form of symmetry, in the form of regularity. But life is not always so nice to us. So this dragon example I showed you before, it took us many, many years to actually detect the symmetry or the regularity on the scales. And this brings us back to the noise issue, because this is a very difficult and central issue in symmetry detection or regularity detection. that when do you say it's a pattern and when do you distinguish it from noise, right? This is what we do all the time when we look at patterns around us in life or in anything else that you would like to say. Now, we needed a different way of detecting this type of patterns with high degree of noise and data corruption. Okay. So let me define what I mean by regularity. Now, regularity, at the beginning, when I talked about symmetry, I said this part is a reflected copy of this part. So that's a symmetry, right? But now we need something better, because if we try to do these pairwise relations, we will have errors that will accumulate, and this will not end up in lining in the end. Instead, we can solve it as a really global problem. So it might sound odd that at the beginning I mapped a global problem to a local problem, and then I'm going back to the global problem again. This is because for certain types of data, the amount of noise is sufficiently large that you can't do a local analysis anymore. So how can we extract or define these patterns? These patterns are determined by elements that are repeated, and now the elements are less important. It's the repetition pattern which is more important. So this abstraction you see on the right, this is unknown. This is what we will solve for. But if you give me a solution, then I can define regularity by the regularity of this black lines or the graph that you see, right? But this is an embedded graph with particular locations. So by the this is like a dual mesh, if you would, and the regularity is given by how regular are each of the elements or the triangles here. Okay. So we have a vertex regularity. In this case, we have a face regularity. We see how nice these faces are. Okay. So the goal is to find this underlying mesh. So what we do is we take an object, we throw points at it, so we take samples from it, and you can use your favorite algorithm for doing it. And then you generate this, what we call this candidate black edges, or these curves. And these are connected by connecting local neighbors of these black points. And you see they are crisscrossing a lot at this stage, because we let them crisscross at this stage. And then you connect them and into these elements that you would like, and these are colored based on how regular they are. And this is easy to define such a regularity measure, because you can just look at after flattening, how close they are to equilateral triangle, for example. So the regularity energy is quite okay in terms of vertex selection and the face selection, but the interesting bit is we don't know if that edge should be selected or not. So we throw in an indicator variable to find out if they are selected or not, and if they are selected, then we add this weight. And same for the vertex. If the vertex is selected, then we do it. So essentially what we did is we covered it with patches, and then they are overlapping patches at this stage, and then we are looking for a subset of patches which forms this regular net. So that's what we're looking for. And this is the type of optimization that comes up, which is a mixed integer formulation. There's these XVs, which XV are the indicator for the vertex, and XP are the indicator for the patches. Okay. So the regularity energy is what we showed before. The messiness comes in the next part, where you have to make sure that once these patches are selected, they cover the object and there's nicely forms a manifold. And this part we cannot explain in this talk, but you have to believe that that is a sufficient condition to ensure that the collection of selected patches is indeed covering the surface nicely. And this is the type of results you would get. So now these blue are the selected edges. All these other edges has been marked out because they were not the minimum for this mixed integer optimization. And then you can go ahead and edit the patterns. So you should notice that the pattern has been edited. So if you have worked with it, you know that these are the scales of the dragon. And then they have been replaced by this rosy pattern. It seems like quite nice and exciting that we can detect these patterns. I was very excited after having this result, because it took us maybe 6 to 7 years to reach this final formulation. But it may not immediately show the impact or the possibility that you can get out of it. Now, if you look here, Now, once we have determined that these are near regular, hence the name, you can replace them with exactly regular patterns, right? So you can change the shape, and that's what you have done. Now, only a subset of people will be excited if you can change it on a dragon, but then when you do it on a building, there are a lot more people who are excited. And why is that? Because if you take these panels, you see these instances there, and if they're repeated, then you can use the same mold for creating this. So for example, these glasses were all made with the same mold, and that makes the fabrication cost significantly lower. And this is the type of technique that was used for constructing this Eiffel Tower first floor pavilion. For these structures here, they were created with optimization, as explained above, to ensure that there's you sort of change the shape to make it more symmetric or more regular. And this has mathematical beauty, but this has also a huge financial beauty because your cost of production suddenly goes down. And that's why I like UCL a lot, because our logo says they change the world, right? So it's quite nice. So we want to change the world to make it more regular or symmetric. So the summary so far is what we have is we have mapped the symmetry detection to a clustering problem, and this regularity detection as instead of finding this graph, either directly using generators or using this mixed integer formulation that I talked about. Okay, so this was around 2012 or 13. Then we said, okay, we are in a bit of trouble because we can nicely structure the symmetry and regularity. What do we do next? Right? And this was also a good time because at that time, Google decided they would get into this 3D modeling industry, and they came up with lots of models that, and modeling tools, and people started to generate models and put it online. This is a substantial community, and now it's called Trimble Warehouse. So now we start looking for relations not between objects itself, but across objects. Again, these are some of weird objects you will find in the envelope you have with you. Okay, so now we have these unstructured 3D models, which I call model collections, which are only tied loosely based on keywords. Right? So in this case, it's aeroplanes. So you search in aeroplanes, and you get pages of these entries. And then the goal is, can we find some structure from this? And I'll give you some heads up where this is going, because once you have a structure from this, this gives you what sort of shapes are planes, right? So you can sample from this distribution, and then you get new planes. So this gives us a generative way of creating more and more models, right? With some limitation, because you can only create what you have seen. So keep that in mind. This is a generative one. And of course, we'll be biased by data. And we'll only do more of the same in some way. So the problem is we have model collections. And we want to find some sort of a pattern under this. Of course, you can go ahead and find symmetry of these planes and symmetry types. And you would find two or three dominant symmetry types of what are being repeated. But this does not give us quite a synthesis algorithm or a distribution that we were after. So what we would instead like to do is, what is a deformation that takes me from one plane to another? And if I can find it, then if I go like part way along this path, I would hopefully get a new instance or a new model that is still quite a plane. So that's where we are going. Okay? So if you go to a different representation, which we call a descriptor space, which is a many-to-one mapping, so you take an object and map it to a point in this space, right? And now this transformation domain, or this description domain, so it will take all these points and map them to points here. And these are points in some high-dimensional space. And the goal is we want to collect these dots, right? But these will not be just collected by a curve in this case. In generally, it will be a subsurface or a surface in there with a particular structure. And then the hope is if there is a low degree of freedom for the deformation, these curves or these surfaces will be easy to represent and walk along. I do understand that being an evening lecture, this can get heavy at some point, but we'll switch gears after a few more slides. Okay, so if we focus in a particular region, we have multiple points here. And the goal is, if you remember, this point was a shape that from where it came, and this point is another shape. And now I want to find this curve, and I want to travel this curve, right? So that sounds very, very simple. This seems like data analysis, quite simple. You have points, doesn't matter which dimension you are, you connect them, and you get the shape back, right? But there is a problem. The problem being, in going from here to here, we did a drastic reduction in the number of degrees of freedom, right? Because this is a many-to-one mapping. Which means if I take a point here, I cannot lift it so easily, right? And that's a very central problem in our area, that going back or creating or filling in this empty space is quite difficult. And only later we have some ways of how we will lift it back. But in this case, what we would do, that the observation is, although we cannot lift it back, but we can deform one of these base models and track it such that the deformation, so you look for a deformation such that its signature of this many-to-one map function follows the curve. Right? So the optimization is quite hairy, but it turns out you can actually do it closed form, and I'll explain a little bit. So you have a low degree of deformation m, but what you want is the signature or the mapping of this function, of this object, is this point, but it also traces out the curve. So essentially, you were solving for the deformation that follows the curve well. Okay? So that's what you were trying to do. So that's what you were trying to do, and you can write this down algorithmically or in terms of optimization, where what you're doing is you solve for this deformation such that the model under the deformation gives a signature which is close to its neighboring signature, and the deformations are also smooth, right? So this is what we're looking for. Now, a part that I'm not going to talk about is how do you extract this low complexity deformation model. That can also be quite nicely done. So if you do this, what you get is, for this point, you get the highlighted blue box is the template that is being deformed, and if you see here, the deformation is almost the wings are moving forward and backward, and if you take the corresponding signature, it follows the blue line. Now, why is this exciting? Because now it gives a natural ordering for these green points. Because I can follow this curve, and I can get this, right? Get ordering for these input models. It seems like a very powerful idea, because we have solved both the deformation and the curves at the same time. But let's see what it means on the data. So I will show an example where we will show the output, which is we will get the blue curve, and we will get the ordering according to the blue curve, and we will traverse along that. And first, I will show it for motorcycles. Okay. So these deformations were found, and as you drag the arrangement of the wheels, so you move the wheels back, you get more to the chopper part of the model cycles. Right? So this is from, I think, from 200 or 300 collection of this. And then you can also find other choppers around that space, or you can move them closer, and you get more like these moped-type scenarios. Okay. So you see here. At this point, what we do is we also throw in bikes in this data set. And now if you move them away, you still get these choppers, which you should. Since the deformation has been redone, when you move the seat above or this, and you go to the bike part of the data set. Right? So in this case, what has happened is we have taken this data, crunched our machinery, and found an ordering of this data set. It's very important to remember that no data has been created. We are just sorting the original models, which I always find is the easier version. Then it took us a few years to go from there to I'll say 2 or 3 years, to go from there to actually extracting some sort of geometric prior. And I won't have time to explain the method here, but the result would be like if you take these chairs, we get, if you do a rigid alignment without factoring out deformations, you get like mostly a mess of points. But when you factor out the deformation, if you have rightly done it, you see these sort of points are getting closer to a chair, and these strange legs that you see is because we see a superimposition between four-legged chairs and the cross four-legged chairs. So these are two clusters superimposed in each other. So what the underlying machinery does is you can almost think of taking like a picture with your camera. You're focusing your deformation slider such that the superimposition gets simpler in here. And at this, when we were working on this, we were quite a bit inspired by the work here for dolphins, where certain shape space was found out here. Now, because we found these deformations and we found the distribution, now you can go ahead and sample from the space. So in this case, this is, again, back to the bikes. But now we will actually be working in the void. So if you are moving into the white points, these boxes are changing their shapes and their distributions or their sizes. And you can actually ask for actual geometry at any point. And when you click on it, these are instances of bikes created from here. And this is quite exciting in the sense now we have a space where we can sample and we can get instances of the bikes. And the hope is that we will get more and more data and we will get a better encoding of this manifold as a space that we have. So this gives us this class-specific shape prize. So we take this, we have it. Okay. So at this point, I'll take a detour and explain one of the applications that I find quite interesting, given the title of the talk I proposed, that you can take shapes and you can understand what function it came from in this case. So in this case, we could take raw meshes and found out how they interact with each other, which we call the interaction graph. And that tells me how this assembly of parts are linked and connect to each other. So in this case, it tells you geometrically, if you move this pink gear, how the motion is going to be propagated. And it again comes back to the slippage analysis you can do on geometry. And not surprisingly, it's linked to the symmetry of the shapes. But that determines what parts can interact with each other. So in this case, this is analysis output of this assembly of gears, where the original model is shown on the bottom left. And if you rotate it, it tells you how the motion is going to be propagated. So this allows you a rigging of this of the shape without having to go through this complicated rigging mechanism. I should be very clear in saying that this was not a scan, right? This was a model. So the problem of starting from a scan and fabricating or finding this function, that's still open as I understand as of now. So that's a good direction to look at. But this allowed us to create a fun project here where we could take function in the form of a walking sequence of a person, that was the input, and come up with assembly of gears which would actually function with a single driver, which is behind this yellow sheet of paper, so just below the person holding it. So I will play it one more time so that you can see it. So the motor is just behind the finger on the other side of the paper. Otherwise, there's just too much clutter here. So that's a good point to transition to this computational design aspect. And there will be two threads I will talk about. One is a work that I personally find really exciting and really nice that puts everything in one framework, which is how do we manipulate or work with constraint spaces? And this is what we extracted last time. So in the first part, we extracted these relations and how and these transformations. And now we want to manipulate shapes such that these are preserved. At this point, I'll say the next few slides will have some equations, and I will try to give you the intuition what's going on. But then we will go to the fun stuff of actually designing with that. And if there's too many hands showing up that we should move on, I can move on from this part. But this is the part I really find exciting. So here's the goal, right? So we have a single model with certain set of constraints. So in this case, the constraint is each of this quad element is planar, right? Which sounds like a trivial condition, but it's not, because you can have a quad like this and it's going to be not planar, right? So this is no longer a trivial condition when you go from a triangle, which is always planar, to a quad, which is not planar. And for architecture, this is quite important, because they would like to build from glass facades, and if they cut from planar quads, then it's a lot simpler. So the constraints are, for each face, we have a planarity condition. But that's not important. What's important is, for each face, you have some algebraic equation that is satisfied. You can put in the planarity condition here as a determinant, or you can put in your favorite constraints here. Right? And as long as it links a set of vertices, that's what you have. So to repeat, what we have is a single shape with a set of constraints. So in this case, there are a set of constraints for each face, and blue means that the constraint is satisfied. That means this energy is equal to zero. And then our goal is to find the deformation, which is, how do I change the whole shape? So this is shown by this weird yellow arrows. So by strange yellow arrows, it means that this point moves here, this point moves here. So effectively, it gives me the new shape. And we are looking for the set of yellow arrows such that the constraints are still satisfied. Okay? If we can do that, then we can traverse along these yellow arrows and create new shapes. Okay? So that would be here. And I will first show you the result, and then I will show you what we get. So if you traverse along this yellow arrow, you start from this original point, and you move further and further, your constraints are still going to be all satisfied. Blue means good, right? So the red means, in this case, it's going to be bad. So you can go further to B, and only when you get to quite extreme deformation, you start to get this red quads. Okay? So that's good. But those who like geometry, this would be quite exciting and interesting. Because we are in higher dimension, we don't have a single normal, but sort of a family of normals. And that sounds quite odd, right? So if you have a surface, and if you take a point, we have a unique normal. But because we are in a high dimensional space with an interesting co-dimension, we don't have a single normal, but we have a sort of a collection of normals, which sounds quite counterintuitive at this point. But it will be explained. So what we have is, we have these energies. We have the starting configuration where the energies are zero, so that's all good. And then we want to find a deformation such that the energies don't change. So we want to move orthogonal to these deformations, right? So you want to move orthogonal to this gradient. But there is not one gradient, there's as many constraints, so that many gradients. So we have that many constraints, but still enough degree of freedom is left out. But once we can traverse on this tangent surface, you can find a basis vector. For those who enjoy linear algebra, you can run your PCA and you find the basis vector there. So now you have a way to represent any point or any vector on this tangent space. But then you can do a Taylor expansion by looking for the osculent in this space. And if you write out the energy, what happens is, the gradient term that you see here, the second order term, in this case, that gets canceled. So when you write it out, if you ignore this, these expressions, the important bit is the term that EI, which are the basis for the tangent vector, is orthogonal to this grad of EI, because this is by definition or by construction. Right? So that term drops away magically, and that means we can now look for equations such that these are true up to second order. All this means is, up to second order, the change in energy is zero for all the d constraints. So that's what it says. And how many constraints do we have depends on the number of equations we have, right? Number of constraints you have given me. And if you do the counting, you have, these are the knowns. These, you have enough knowns so you can solve for the unknowns here. Which are the unknowns are the coefficients in, if you go back, please excuse me here one more time. So the unknowns are the AIs, which are the coefficients of the second order expansion. Those are the unknowns. Ni, Njs are the normals that we know. Uis are the basis of these coefficients here. And there's enough equations to solve it. So the takeaway message at this point is, if you run through the math, and this is looks a bit scary, but you can actually do it, then there's enough equations, or there's enough things you can compute on the original one and the EIs that you can find out the coefficients. And why is it exciting? Why is it exciting to find these coefficients? Because once you can find this coefficient, then I don't have to just move on the tangent surface. I can move on actually on the osculant surface. That means I can move further while the constraints are still satisfied. This is very exciting. So if you see here, now these deformations are no longer lines, but these parabolic curves, because we are looking for the second order forms. And does it work? Of course, this should work. So if you traverse along this osculant, you can go further with lower error, which is quite good. Which means if you have lots of degrees to solve for, you don't have to solve that often. You can go further before you recompute. Okay. Now, why is this exciting for computational design? Because now it gives us opens up a new paradigm for creating new shapes. Because now we can navigate this space and get new instances. Before I show the second video, or the video for this, now if you think of this planarity condition we had here, a simple example will be if we start with a planar curve, like on the plane, because by definition, they will all be planar, right? So it's easy to come up with one instance. And then by doing this analysis, as you see here, you can lift it to whichever dimension you would like to have. So as you move, so that's the output which is shown to the user. The user can navigate this shape space, and whenever they freeze the design, this is guaranteed to be good up to the engineering constraints, which is quite nice because then you can go ahead and design and fabricate it without having to worry about the projection and how it changes things. Okay, so I will use it for two or three examples of how we envision this can help in guiding the designer. Now, when I think of design, it comes often from sketches. And there are people with different expertise of how they sketch and what level they're sketching. And then the goal is, can we lift this to 3D, and can we lift this with some engineering work? Okay. So we are done with the equation, so that's all good for now. But this is how, when we talk with our friends in product design, this is how they usually design this. So this is from Anvil, as you see here. So they sketch and they create these different forms of how this works. And they also like to prototype things. And the reason they would prototype is they know that between this going from the sketching through the 3D modeling to the actual fabrication, there are jumps. So they would like to see this way ahead, how these things are coupled, how these things are actually going to be. And and then they would go ahead and actually make it many instances of this. And here, I think, is a big opportunity for us in computer science, especially, and also those who like data analysis and also optimization, that we can really sort of combine these different stages into one. And this is not a question of making things cheaper or making things faster, but allowing the same people to go through all the stages of design. Because if you are trying to change a knob without seeing how the system is reacting, it's very difficult. So for example, if you, now you're getting a bit into winter, if you are turning the knob of your heating in your office and you don't know how it responds, and some of you may or may not have this experience, it's very frustrating to try to adjust the system. And now imagine this with many, many knobs, right? So we want to combine this into a pipeline that everyone can work together here. So we don't want this separate name for the different stages, but our goal is, can we collapse this or give previews of them early on in the design so that you don't make these errors? Okay. So I'll show you for example that we did recently, and with this philosophy in mind, that if you think of stability for furniture, like when you design this, you want this to be stable, and you also want to be durable, that when you put in enough weight, it still takes the load, and you don't want things to just fall over, right? And the main thing is we want real-time feedback, which is easy to do if you have a powerful FEM simulator. You want to tell the user how far they should go before things will break down. And the most important thing is we'll tell them how to get back to the good region of the shape space. So you can think of in terms of furniture, you can think of in terms of shapes and models and chairs, or you can think of the examples we saw with constraints shapes before. So when things gets non-durable, it will propose suggestions how to fix things. So that's the design paradigm, I think, which is very exciting to look at. So if you are in the current design, we would like to bring them back to the good space of the design space. And the most important thing is when they're outside, when they're in this red, we will provide multiple ways of restoring the validity. So in this case, we do with durability and stability, but you can think for other things. So that's hence the name guided design. Okay. So let's just see the system in action. Okay. So what's going on is the user is changing the shape of one of these planks, and the others are automatically being adjusted, or they're given suggestions of how to adjust the planks to go back to the correct region. And these weird things you see on the top are weights that you give as function for these planks. Okay. You can actually download this and play on your laptop. The reason this is super useful, at least I found it very useful, is because it tells you how to synchronize this multiple movement, which is hard. If you have three planks, you know how to build a table. You don't need the tool for that. But if you have many planks like this, then you would need this. Okay, so at this point, I will answer one of the things I gave you, the blue object I gave you. So let's, for those who haven't seen this, can you tell me what, anyone has a guess what this is? For anyone who hasn't seen it, I can see Tim smiling because he has seen it many times. Okay, so if you see here, I'll see, I don't know if it works or not. Depends on your cartoon background. So you probably, if you squint your eye, you can see the Mickey there. You can see the Snoopy there. Maybe that's and that's the Popeye, I'm not holding it right. Okay. If you do it in a more controlled setting, this is what you see. This is the same one, another print of that. Now when you cast the shadows, you get this interesting effects, right? Now, why did I want to bring this back? Because one was to keep you guys engaged, but also to show you that there's a lot of potential here, as in it's not just allowing people to do things faster, but allowing them to, our designers, like anyone, to do things that they couldn't do before. Now, you can do a single view shadow, that's super simple, you can do it. I'm sure you can do it. With two view, you can do it. But as soon as it gets to three view, for those who in vision, you know you can't do it for arbitrary curves. And that's what this paper was about. If you are given arbitrary curves, how do you deform them? Again, change the world such that you get these interesting shadows. Right? Now, again, often our research is motivated by we see something, we love it, and we do it. But then it leads to something that's actually useful. And here is an example, and I'll talk about this is Martin's work that we did a while back, that there are these interesting origami shapes, but not origami with straight folds that you are most familiar with. But when you use this curved fold, you can get very intricate shapes from a single sheet of paper. Now, here is a very mundane sheet of paper that you see here with some strange lines, the blue and red. It means that you have to fold it this way or that way. And believe it or not, this object was created from such a single piece of paper. And I will just show you a little bit of this. Also use it for a bit of advertisement for UCL. So this is the folded shape gradually being shaped. And this is something you would need the expertise from Martin. And this is a single sheet that is being used. Of course, you understand that we are only talking about the white stuff, not the plyboard, where that's just a boundary condition. And this is how it looks here. And this is another examples. You're welcome to come here later and see it. This is all from a single piece that you see here. And this fancy arrangement on the top and bottom is just to keep the shape, right? So it's just to hold it. Now, why is this exciting for manufacturing and fabrication? Because it allows us to build things super cheaply now, right? But cheap without sacrificing the beauty of the shape, right? You can build it very effectively. You don't have any cutting. You don't have any gluing. Very, very interesting stuff we find. And I will conclude with this part, which is another input that we often neglect, but now that we are having priors, we can now lift sketches and 3Ds based on the priors to 3D. Now, why is this exciting? Because now it can allow us, and this I'm saying in future because this is what we are working on, it can allow us to lift sketches directly to 3D objects. So the designers can sketch, and we can lift it to 3D. This would be quite useful. So the first one that we have so far is something where we use the vanishing line direct information from the background and allow people to directly sketch. And as soon as they sketch, they're sketching in a single view. They're just rotating to get an idea of how it looks in 3D. But this modeling, this I call it modeling, because they're not doing any modeling like before. You continue to sketch. So this was an architect who was from Bartlett, who worked with us for about 4 to 6 months, gave us many feedback. So this is after the final iteration. You sketch, and whenever you are done, you have the 3D model, or a very good realization of the 3D model. And they were quite excited, because not everyone in their domain have the modeling capability. And it's still the person who's sketching can still get a good preview of what's going on here. Okay? And the stuff you see on the right, a different interpretation of our system is coming up. And it's a good sign that they're always taking the top, because it's suggesting what is a very good, plausible way. Now, again, for those in vision, there's no magic here. Here we are looking for a particular type of structure, which are these planes and the embeddings of these planar curves. But this arrangement of planes makes it quite a strong regularizer to actually lift the curves to 3D. And we are quite excited about this. And that's what we call designing in context, or sketching in context. Mark had a really good paper a couple of years back on directly doing a data-driven approach of lifting sketches through 3D, and I see that as a way of machine learning applied to these geometric priors that we talked about earlier on. So before doing some fun things, I will talk about some future thoughts. So I think we have some understanding of how shapes are sort of shaped by functional preferences. For example, seats have particular heights, chairs and tables have particular ratios of heights, etc. And there are books that have been written on these ergonomic laws, etc. So that's a good domain to extract data from. Now, here is something I showed for the shape space of how you can extract this good few directions to manipulate shapes and understand shapes, which we call valid shapes, but we are still missing tools how to expose this to the user, because this is quite difficult to expose it to the user without them getting lost that there's too many dimensions still left to use it. So this is more a question for those who are in HCI and in knowing what are good ways to express this to the user. And a part that we are working on, and I hope we will see a lot of work in the next years, is can we synthesize purely based on functional specifications? We have done some work on prototyping on this case, and also on designing of street networks and others only from functional specification. And I think this is what we talked about, was going from sketches to retrieval, which is, this is the result. I think Mark could already do a few years back. But what we would like to do is close the loop and suggest new designs that are not just retrievals, but more closer to that. And that's the puzzle you have with you. And why is this exciting? Because the constraints are not only coming from the original sketch. This is an instance where you cut it out from acrylic or if it's wood, or etc. I frequently visit the timber yard we have locally, and if you get like good quality wood, it can get expensive. And it's interesting because you don't waste much space here. You don't waste in these type of designs. So can we now interpret and also optimize from the material size? And this has huge implications. Like this was another example where you don't cut at all, but if you cut, you cut only a few paces, and then you suggest modification to the user where you would design something. And this is something I plan to do for our home design, such a coffee table. But something we already did, earlier this year, we moved, this is a, I think last example I will show. So recently we moved to a house and we moved in, we had this quite a bit grubby kitchen, and I thought this is a good example that we can use our tools for designing. So what we started with is we took a few photos and created some sort of a very abstracted 3D model, so we can look at it. And then we stripped out everything. So this was earlier in March or April. And then we used our system to design with these lines you see to get a preview. And this tool helped me a lot in deciding which IKEA modules I will get. Right? And a lot of my time was spent in copying back dimensions from there to here. But this was sufficient for telling me, taking design decisions, like which one will work, which one will not. Some of the things I had to do manually, like if the door opens on the fridge, how much of the space is remaining, who's going to be positioned near the sink, or et cetera. But I think this is a very exciting time when we can combine fabrication, manufacturing, design specifications for our indoor and also for buildings that we actually saw. I do want to take a couple of moments to thank my group who's here, except for the tallest guy who is in Japan now because he has to give a talk at SIGGRAPH Asia. So I'm very proud to have this group at UCL. I don't know what they say behind me, but when we are together, we work quite hard. And I think it's really fun to have this team and being able to work on this domain. For my time from my PhD years to the postdoc, et cetera, I had a wonderful set of collaborators and people where I learned a lot, not only about working ethics and what to work on, what problems to pick, but I think most importantly, I also picked up a certain way of lifestyle from certain of these people, a mix of this, which I really like. And I wanted to take this opportunity to also thank my parents for the wonderful childhood and education we had. And we're very lucky that they are here today. And my family and my kid in more exciting times. Right? So I will encourage you to look at the problems the other way around, because this tells you different angles. And I will point you or encourage you to go to our website and download the code and data. Most of them are available. And please do contact us if you have if anything's not working or any link is broken, because we have also benefited a lot by the data collections we have seen from others, and we had the chance of using it. So I think with the community, we can only move forward if we have resources where we can quickly reproduce results, et cetera. So that's all I had to say today. And thank you very much for your patience and your... thank you.